Hello and welcome to Unacademy's Let's Crack UPSC CSE in English channel. I am Rajshekhar Reddy, faculty for current affairs. To tell something about myself, I have cleared the civil service examination in the year 2014 and I have significant experience teaching civil services aspirants. I have been teaching for the past 7 years. I am a BTech computer science graduate from JNTU Hyderabad and my experience in writing this examination will be very useful for you to crack this exam at the earliest point of time. You need to download and subscribe to the Unacademy Learning app. Unacademy is India's largest and finest platform for online civil services education. They have made rapid progress over the past couple of years in the field of online civil services education and have produced several ranks. You get a number of benefits by downloading and subscribing to the Unacademy Learning app. So the most important benefit that you get is the advantage of daily live classes. So you have daily live classes wherein you can chat with your educator, ask questions on various issues that are being discussed with the educator, answer questions that are asked by the educator. All these can be done while the class is going on. So while the class is going on, you can engage in various discussions with the educator. The courses that are available on the Unacademy Learning app are structured in nature, so they comprehensively deal with the syllabus. So the syllabus will be comprehensively dealt from A to Z in the Unacademy Learning app. You have live tests and quizzes conducted very often by educators on the Learning app. And most importantly, you have unlimited access to the content on the Learning app. So you can watch the videos any number of times and you can watch from the comfort of any of your devices at any place of your choice. India's best educators are teaching on the Unacademy platform. So we have Roman Saini, Mrunal Patel, Sudarshan Gurjar and other top educators who teach regularly on the Unacademy platform. Different courses are designed by these people for your convenience. So we have a number of courses in polity, history, current affairs, etc. So as I've told you, you need to download and subscribe to the Unacademy Learning app. So there are various subscription options available. You can subscribe for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. The best option is the 24 month subscription because this gives you a 67% discount. So you get a 67% discount. So this is a huge discount that you get and this will be valid for 2 years. And you can get an additional 10% discount if you use my code RRUPSC. So please use my code RRUPSC when you download and subscribe to this channel. So you can convert the final transaction amount. So that is the final transaction amount is 57,600 and you can convert this into no cost EMS. You can convert this into no cost EMS which can be extended to 24 months. So Unacademy is relatively cheap compared to other institutions. Offline institutions are very expensive in India. Unacademy is relatively cheap and you have unlimited access. You can watch the videos again and again till you understand on the Unacademy platform. So let us continue with the topics on current affairs. So as you all know, I have started a series called Top 200 Topics in Current Affairs for Civil Services Prelims 2020. So this is the series. We have already finished 7 lectures and this is the 8th lecture. So we will be dealing with the following 7 topics in this lecture. So what are these topics? So first is an index that is very important. So Sustainable Development Goals Index 2020. This report has been released very recently. We will also discuss the version of the Sustainable Development Goals Index in India that is called the SDG India Index. We will discuss about a type of fish which was recently declared extinct. So this Chinese paddlefish was declared extinct so recently. So we will discuss about this very important issue that has been in the news. We will also discuss the Conference of Parties. So Conference of Parties are meetings held at regular intervals to examine or analyze the progress made in the realization of objectives of various conventions. So we will look into the Conference of parties that were held for three different conventions in the recent period. There is a very important topic called creative cities. So what are creative cities and which cities from India have been designated as creative cities? We will also discuss about some public sector enterprises and how are they designated as Maharatna, Navaratna and Miniratna. And lastly, we will discuss a very important military exercise that is in the news. So Malabar, Exercise Malabar, which is in the news. So these are the seven topics which will be discussed in today's class. So let us start with the first topic. So first topic is Sustainable Development Goals Index. So as you all know, indexes are very important for your exam. So there will be at least 1 to 2 questions which will be asked on indexes. Mark my words, so there will be at least 1 to 2 questions that will be asked on indexes. We have discussed a number of indexes. For example, Global Hunger Index is one index which we have done. Human Development Index has been done. Rule of Law Index has been done. The Environmental Protection Index has been done. So you must remember all such indexes. They will be frequently asked in the examination. I have already told you that when you study about indexes, there is a specific pattern that you need to follow. This is you need to know about the index. You must also know the parameters that are used for calculating or formulating that index. Apart from that, you must also know India's rank in this index, best ranking country, and if possible, you also must know the worst ranking country. And if there are any other related issues, you have to study about that. So let us see what is the Sustainable Development Goals Index. So Sustainable Development Goals Index is an index that is released by what is called Sustainable Development Solutions Network. So this is an index which is released by a combination of two organizations. So you can see here, it is prepared by independent experts at the Sustainable Development Solutions Network and the Bertelsmann Stiftung. So Bertelsmann Stiftung and Sustainable Solutions Development Network prepare the United Nations Sustainable Development Index. So Sustainable Development Index is an index prepared by Sustainable Development Solutions Network. So it is a report that is prepared annually. So it is released every year. This is a report that is released every year. So the Sustainable Development Report is the first worldwide study to assess where each country stands in regard to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. As you all know, Sustainable Development Goals are a set of 17 goals which were adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in the year 2015. So UN General Assembly has adopted a set of 17 goals and 169 targets in the year 2015. These Sustainable Development Goals replaced what is called Millennium Development Goals, which were adopted in the year 2000. So Millennium Development Goals must be fulfilled by the end of 2015, and after the end of 2015, we adopted a new set of goals, keeping in view the latest developments that have taken place all over the world, and we have adopted a set of new goals which are called Sustainable Development Goals. The Sustainable Development Report is the first worldwide study to assess where each country stands with regard to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. Unlike its predecessor, the Millennium Development Goals, the Sustainable Development Goals set standards not only for emerging and developing countries but also for industrialized nations. So Sustainable Development Goals, unlike Millennium Development Goals, cover a wide range of issues, and they have to be achieved not just by developing countries, they also must be achieved by industrialized nations. So this is a very important point that you need to know. This is a report which was launched in the year 2016, and it is, as I have told you, it is released annually. And it gives an up-to-date information regarding the progress made by all UN member states on the Sustainable Development Goals. So there are no specific parameters. The parameters itself are the 17 goals. So what is the progress made by countries in achieving these particular goals? So what is India's rank? So this is something which is very, very important. So India's rank in the Sustainable Development Goals Index is 117. So this is very, very important for your exam. So India's rank is 117. They have taken into consideration 166 countries. So out of 166, India is ranked very poorly at 117 countries. The score given by India is 61.92. The score given to India is 61.92. If a country has a score of 100, it implies that the country has fulfilled all the goals and targets under the SDG. So India, which has ranked at 117 with a score of 61.92, is also facing major challenges in 10 out of the 17 sustainable development goals, including zero hunger, good health, gender equality, among others. Apart from scoring very poorly on the SDG index, India also faces a number of challenges as far as achieving 10 of the 17 sustainable development goals are concerned. So the report says that India faces challenges in achieving 10 out of the 17 goals. Apart from this, you must also know the best ranking countries. So the country which ranks first in this index is Sweden. Sweden ranks first, and the country which ranks last is CAR, that is the Central African Republic. So Central African Republic has a rank of 166. So this is something which you need to remember, very, very important for your prelims examination. So these are the 17 goals. These are called the sustainable development goals. So first goal is no poverty. Second is zero hunger. Third, good health and well-being. Fourth, quality education. Fifth, gender equality. Sixth, clean water and sanitation. 7. Affordable and clean energy. 8. Decent work and economic growth. 9. Industry, innovation and infrastructure. 10. Reduced inequalities. 11. Sustainable cities and communities. 12. Responsible consumption and production. 13. Climate action. 14. Life below water. 15. Life on land. 16. Peace, justice and strong institutions. 17. Partnering for the goals. So these are the 17 goals. So you need to find a way to remember all these goals. Everything is important. You can be asked a question in the mains examination also, and you can also expect a question on in general essay also on sustainable development goals. So this is the assessment given by the SDG index for India. So as far as India is concerned, you can see the red marks here. So you can see here. So we are lagging in these areas. So we have major challenges in areas which are marked as red. So we have challenges in achieving zero hunger, good health and well-being, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy. Then we have industry, innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, peace, justice and strong institutions, partnership for the goals. So there are 10 major challenges. So the SDG report says that India faces 10 major challenges out of the 17. So you can see here the different colors that have been given. So except for one, that is climate action, where we have made significant progress, we are facing challenges on all other fronts. So what is the improvement made by India, and in which areas have we made improvement? So as far as eliminating poverty is concerned, we have shown some improvement. Similarly, we have shown improvement as far as providing clean drinking water and sanitation are concerned, decent work and economic growth, and climate action. So these are the four goals in which we are showing good progress. But we have actually shown a decrease in the progress as far as life on land is concerned. As far as zero hunger, good health and well-being, affordable and clean energy, industry, innovation and infrastructure are concerned, so we are actually moderately improving. And for the remaining goals, we are stagnating. So we are as we were in the last year. So this is for your information. So this is the trends which was noted with respect to India by the SDG report. So this is about the Sustainable Development Goals Index. So Sustainable Development Goals, so there is a simple way that you have to remember. So the United Nations Sustainable Development Solutions Network releases the Sustainable Development Index. It is released annually, and this report has ranked 166 countries. India's rank is 117. The best ranking country is Sweden. And the worst ranking country is CAR. Apart from this, you need to remember that there are no specific parameters. The 17 goals themselves act as parameters. And India faces major challenges in attaining 10 sustainable development goals. So this is what you need to remember. So as you all know, sustainable development goals must be achieved by India at any cost, and for achieving these goals, India has also developed one more index called Sustainable Development Goals India Index, SDG India Index. So this was developed in the year 2018. It was released for the first time in 2018, and the second report was released on December 30, 2019. So which organization prepares this report? So this report is prepared by NITI Aayog. So NITI Aayog is the organization which releases the SDG India Index. This is very important. So they have prepared and released it annually. This is also a report which is released annually. So it is constructed for 16 out of the 17 goals. So they take 16 goals into consideration for formulating the SDG index. So for SDG 17, they actually have a qualitative assessment. So they don't have quantifiable data. So they just have qualitative assessment for goal number 17. So the progress made by all states and union territories can be seen in the SDG India Index. So SDG India Index helps us to understand the progress made by various states in achieving the sustainable development goals. So the SDG India Index 2019-20 is intended to provide a holistic view on the social, economic and environmental status of the country and its states and union territories. So it is aimed at providing a holistic view on the social, economic and environmental status of the country and its states and union territories. It has been designed to provide an aggregate assessment of the performance of all Indian states and union territories and to help leaders and change makers evaluate their performance on social, economic and environmental parameters. So it also acts as an indicator for the leaders to check their performance on various fronts, that is social, economic and environmental fronts. So there is a composite score given to each and every state. So a composite score of per SDG index was computed in the range of 0 to 100. So every state has a score somewhere between 0 to 100, and on the basis of this score that a state gets, they are classified into 4 categories. So this is important. So states are classified into 4 categories. So if the score is between 0 and 49, it is placed in this category called aspirant. Then the score between 50 and 64 places a state in performer category. Then we have the front runner category, which has a score between 65 and 99, and achiever category, which has a score of 100. Overall, India's score in this SDG India index is 60. So we have made an improvement from 57. So we had a score of 57 last year, and we have improved it by 3 points, that is, the score is 60. So we have actually succeeded in some areas, especially water and sanitation, power and industry. However, nutrition and gender equality continue to be a problem for India. So there are many areas where these issues persist, and we need to have a focused approach on lifting many people out of poverty and bring out of malnutrition. So what is the ranking for various states? So this is important. So the state which ranks first in the Sustainable Development Goals India Index is Kerala. So Kerala has a score of 17. As I have told you, India has a score of 60. Overall, India has a score of 60. Kerala, however, is the best performing state in India. It has a score of 70. Kerala is followed by Himachal Pradesh. Himachal Pradesh has a score of 69. Himachal Pradesh is followed by Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Telangana, and these three states have a score of 67. Bihar is the worst performing state of India. So Bihar has fared very poorly. It has a score of 50. So Jharkhand, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Uttar Pradesh are also worst performing states. However, with respect to Uttar Pradesh, there is some good news. Uttar Pradesh has shown maximum improvement, followed by Odisha and Sikkim. Chandigarh has topped the list with the score of 70. In the Union Territories category, Chandigarh has a score of 70, followed by Puducherry. So this is something which you need to remember. So the SDG India Index is published by Niti Aayog annually. The progress made by states and union territories as far as attaining sustainable development goals is measured in the SDG India Index. This is the second annual report, which was released on December 30, 2019. So, a potential question for this year's prelims examination. The state which ranks first is Kerala. Kerala ranks first. Kerala is followed by Himachal Pradesh and Andhra Pradesh. So, this is about the Sustainable Development Index. So, you can see the image here. So, you can see the states and union territories which are in green color, they are in the front runner category. The other states are either in the aspirant category. So there is no state actually in the aspirant category. They are in these three categories. So there is no state in the achiever category also. So India actually has states and union territories either in the performer category or the front runner category. So Bihar is the worst performing state and Kerala is the best performing state. That is what you need to remember. So they have also released the ranking for each and every indicator. So for example, in the achievement of goal 1, that is no poverty, Tamil Nadu ranks first, followed by the union territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. So this I don't think is important, but for your understanding I have added this image also. So please go through this image, you'll have a clear cut understanding as far as the performance of your state in attaining various sustainable development goals. So this is the SDG index. So let us move on to the next topic. So next topic is very, very important for your examination. This topic is called Chinese paddlefish. So this is probably the largest, world's largest freshwater fish species. And it was recently declared as extinct by China. So China has recently declared Chinese paddlefish as extinct. So you need to know a number of points with respect to this issue. So imagine surviving the mass extinction that killed the dinosaurs only to lose your life to humans. So it is very unfortunate that the Chinese paddlefish has existed since the past 200 million years. So they have been on this planet for more than 200 million years and they have survived various calamities and they have also survived the mass extinction. But now they could not survive the human factor. So imagine surviving the mass extinction that killed the dinosaurs only to lose to humans. So owing to human activities, the Chinese paddlefish, one of the world's largest fish that has been around for 200 million years, have not been spotted since 2003. So these fish species have not been spotted since 2003. In 2019, the Chinese government has officially declared it as extinct after carrying out an extensive survey. So they have carried out an extensive survey. So where is this particular fish species found? So this is endemic. So you must remember, so this is found only at a particular place. So this is endemic and this is endemic to a river basin called Yangtze River. So Yangtze River is one of the longest rivers in the world and the Chinese paddlefish is endemic to the Yangtze River. So the Chinese paddlefish is, or rather was, a unique species. China's Yangtze River was once teeming with a particular species of so-called megafish, the Chinese paddlefish. So Chinese Yangtze River was once teeming with these particular fish species. So the largest specimen ever recorded was 7 meters long and weighed 450 kgs, making it one of the largest freshwater fish in the world. They have silvery bodies, so you have to remember that they have silvery bodies and they also have a long snout. So they have a long snout, you can see here, they have a long snout and that is the reason why that this snout is shaped like a paddle. So this is shaped like a paddle, so, and that is the reason why it is called a paddlefish. Okay, so this is the Yangtze River and it was found in the river basin of the Yangtze River and it is declared as extinct. So historically, Chinese paddlefish was caught effortlessly by fishermen. They formed schools swimming on the surface of the river and they were an easy target and they were prized for their plentiful fish and eggs. So this fish species was abundant in the Yangtze River in the 1950s and 60s and they used to move in schools. So they used to move in large numbers, and they became an easy target because of their size and because they swam on the surface of the river. And they were also in demand because of the plentiful flesh. So they have a lot of flesh, and they also are in demand for their eggs. Even ancient Chinese emperors dined on the species. Overfishing. So the reason behind the extinction is overfishing has contributed to the fate. Overfishing has contributed significantly to the fate of the Chinese paddlefish today. But worse was the construction of gazebo dam. This is very, very important. So worst is because of habitat fragmentation. So habitat fragmentation is the reason. So gazebo dam, which was built in 1981, has resulted in hastening the extinction of this particular species. Generous estimates state that there have been less than 100 individual paddlefish left in the wild, down from around 10,000 in the 1970s. The last sighting of a juvenile Chinese paddlefish was in 1995. So a young paddlefish was seen for the last time in 1995, and no specimens have been seen in the wild since 2003, despite extensive surveys. So no Chinese paddlefish was seen since this year, 2003. It was one of the only two living species of paddlefish, the other being the American paddlefish. So there are two types of paddlefish that can be seen in this planet. So one is the American paddlefish that is found in the United States of America, and the other is the Chinese paddlefish. American paddlefish is still in existence, but Chinese paddlefish has become extinct. It is said that there are six different types of paddlefish species. Now five have become extinct. The only remaining paddlefish species in the world is American paddlefish. So a recently published paper estimates the time of extinction to be around 2005 and 2010. So it is estimated that this fish might have become extinct around 2005 and 2010. So what is meant by extinction? So you need to know something about extinction. So extinct means if we have no species left on this planet, then you declare a particular animal as extinct. So extinct means beyond reasonable doubt that the species is no longer extinct. So if there is no doubt that the species is no longer available on this planet, then you declare that particular species as extinct. So a species is extinct when the last existing member dies. A species may become functionally extinct. So there is another word that you need to know, functionally extinct. So before a particular species is declared as extinct, it is usually declared as functionally extinct. So what is a functionally extinct species? So a species may be functionally extinct when only a handful of individuals survive. So when only a handful of individuals, that is 10s or 20s of individuals survive, which cannot reproduce due to poor health, age, sparse distribution over a large range, a lack of individuals of both sexes, or for other reasons. So a functionally extinct animal is someone where the number of individuals of that particular species is very limited, and those limited number of individuals are also having poor health or maybe old age, and they are not in a position to reproduce. So if that is the situation, then that species will be declared as functionally extinct. There is one more term that is used that is called local extinction. So locally extinct implies the species has become extinct in a particular area. So it is not extinct all over the world, but it is extinct in a particular area. For example, cheetah has been declared as extinct in India, but it still survives in Iran. So you need to know the differences between extinct, functionally extinct, and locally extinct. There is one more category that is used by IUCN. So IUCN has this category called extinct in the wild. So extinct in the wild implies that the species is not found in the wild. So no individuals of the species are found in the wild. It is only kept and maintained in artificial environments. So species listed under this status, that is extinct in the wild, by the IUCN are not known to have any living specimens in the wild and are maintained only in zoos or artificial environments. So this is a very, very important point that you need to remember. So extinct in the wild and extinct. So there is a high chance of this question being asked in the examination. Last year, Australia has declared one animal called bramble, K melamis. So it is a type of rodent which has been declared extinct because it was found only on a particular island which was submerged because of sea level rise. So last year, I mean in 2019, I think in February, they have declared this extinct, and Chinese paddlefish has also been declared extinct. So there is a potential question on this particular topic. So this is a very, very important question. So this is about the Chinese paddlefish. So there is no scope for revival of this particular fish species because there is no individual that is kept in captivity, or there is no living tissues available for potential resurrection in the future. So then we will move on to the next topic. So the next topic is called Conference of Parties. So Conference of Parties for various conventions. So this is a topic under So this is a topic under events and locations. So there is a question which is usually asked in the civil service examination. This is events and locations. So they will ask this commonly asked question, events and locations. So they will ask you where was a particular summit held or where was this particular event held. So you must be prepared to expect a question on events and locations, especially with respect to environmental treaties. They will ask these questions. So I have chosen three conventions. One is the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. The other is Convention on Migratory Species. The third is Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Flora and Fauna. So these are the three conventions which will be discussed today. We will not discuss about the conventions. We will actually discuss the latest Conference of Parties. So whoever has signed the convention is called party. So whichever country signs a particular convention, they are called parties, and these parties meet at what is called Conference of Parties. So whenever they meet, it is called a Conference of Parties. They meet at regular intervals to analyze the progress made in attaining the goals set for a particular convention. For example, Climate Change Convention was adopted in 1992. It was adopted during the historic Earth Summit, and the objective of the Climate Change Convention is to prevent climate change from happening. So every year countries meet to discuss the progress that they have made in attaining the targets that they have kept and what needs to be done. So the most important Conference of Parties is Conference of Parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. So this is very, very important for your exam. So the COP25, what does COP25 mean? So Conference of Parties number 25. So this is for the 25th time that the parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change have met. So this is the 25th time. So every year this will be held. So for the Climate Change Convention, parties meet annually. So they will meet annually. So Conference of Parties 25 was recently held at Madrid. This is very, very important for your exam. So COP25 to the convention, like this climate change convention, was held at Madrid. Earlier it was said to be, it was supposed to be hosted by Chile. Chile, that is Santiago in Chile, was the location which initially was supposed to host this event. But because of the protests against the government, this event was shifted from Chile to Spain. So what are the developments that they have that have taken place at this conference? So I'll just go through these developments. So the 25th Conference of Parties to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change was held at Madrid. Chile was supposed to host the event, but Chile's president Sebastian Piñera announced at the end of October that his country could no longer host the event. Piñera blamed different difficult circumstances, referring to violent anti-government protests in the capital of Santiago. So it was initially supposed to be hosted by Chile, but they have cancelled it the last moment, and it was shifted to Madrid, that is Spain. Nearly 27,000 delegates arrived in the Spanish capital in early December, aiming to finalize this rule. So this is also important. So this event was held to finalize what is called the rule book to the Paris Agreement, the operating manual needed when it takes in effect in 2020. So the Paris Agreement comes into force this year, that is 2020. So what are the rules that should be finalized for the implementation of the Paris Agreement were supposed to be finalized at COP25, but they could not be finalized, and now they will be finalized this year, that is in 2020. I think COP26 will be hosted by, if I'm not wrong, Germany, but please check whether I'm correct or not. So, United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres has expressed disappointment with the results of COP25 and that the international community lost an important opportunity to show increased ambition on mitigation, adaptation and finance to tackle the climate crisis. As you know, climate change is the biggest problem that our planet is facing. However, countries have not shown great enthusiasm in dealing with this problem. In fact, USA, which traditionally was the largest polluter in the world, has come out of the Paris Agreement. So this is something unfortunate. So UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres has expressed disappointment with the outcome at COP25. The only saving graces at the conference were the adoption of the new 5-year gender action plan. So gender action plan was adopted at COP25. Apart from the gender action plan, so they have also adopted what is called the Santiago Network for Loss and Damage. So they have also adopted the Santiago Network for Loss and Damage. So this is something which you need to know. So you just have to remember one point, that is COP25 was hosted by the city of Madrid. It was held in December 2019. It was initially supposed to be hosted by Chile, but because of anti-government protests, this event could not be held in Chile. So let us move on to the next convention, that is the CMS convention. So Convention on Migratory Species. So Convention on Migratory Species is also a very important convention. So Convention on Migratory Species, that is CMS, was adopted in the year 1979. It entered into force in 1983. It is also called the Bonn Convention. And this convention aims at protecting migratory birds. You must have come across a number of migratory birds. So migratory birds travel along long distances. They move from one country to another country with the change in season or climate. So we need to protect these migratory species. For example, the perfect example of a migratory species is Siberian crane. Siberian crane comes to India from Siberia during the summer season. So we need to protect the migratory species, and there is a convention to protect the migratory species. This convention is called Convention on Migratory Species. It is also called the Bonn Convention. It was adopted in 1979. It entered into force in 1983. So the 13th conference of parties, so COP13, you need to remember this, the number is 13, COP13, that is the 13th time these people are meeting, was recently held, and it was held in India. So far more important, so it was held in Gandhinagar, Gujarat. So Gujarat hosted the conference of parties number 13. So usually conference of parties will be held once in every 3 years for the Bonn Convention. So an important development has taken place. So 10 new species, so 10 new migratory species were added to what is called Appendix 1. So there are two appendixes that are maintained, Appendix 1. So there are two appendixes that are maintained by the Convention on Migratory Species. So these appendixes provide protection. See here, 7 species were added. You can see here, 7 species were added to Appendix 1. The Asiatic elephant, jaguar, great Indian bustard, Bengal florican, little bustard, Antipodean albatross, and the oceanic white-tipped shark. Migratory species threatened with extinction are listed on Appendix 1 of the convention. This is very important. So migratory species threatened with extinction are listed on Appendix 1. Parties that are reinstates to Appendix 1 species are obliged to afford them strict protection. So whoever is the reinstate, so migratory species move from one place to another place. So wherever this particular migratory species is found, these countries are called reinstates. So reinstates need to give them the highest level of protection. So that is what is meant by Appendix 1. So 7 species were added to Appendix 1. And three species were added to Appendix 2. So the Uriel, smooth hammerhead shark, and the tope shark were added to Appendix 2. COP13 also adopted what is called the Gandhinagar Declaration. So this is also important. So Gandhinagar Declaration calls for migratory species and the concept of ecological connectivity to be integrated and prioritized in the new framework, which is expected to be adopted at the United Nations Biodiversity Conference in October. So Gandhinagar Declaration calls for migratory species and the concept of ecological connectivity to be integrated in the new framework, which will be adopted this year in the month of October at the United Nations Biodiversity Conference. Then we will move on to another conference of parties. Another conference of parties is with respect to CITES, Convention on Endangered Species, Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Flora and Fauna. So the 18th conference of parties was held last year in 2019. So this was held in Geneva. So Geneva hosted the 18th conference of parties to the CITES convention. So CITES convention was adopted in the year 1973 and it entered into force in 1975. I think it was adopted on 3rd March 1973, which is celebrated as the World Wildlife Day. So World Wildlife Day is celebrated on 3rd March, the day of adoption of the CITES convention. So India at the Geneva Conference of Parties has made a proposal for the upgradation of three species. So this is very important. So three species, that is star tortoise, smooth coated otter, and small clawed otters. India made a proposal for the upgradation of these three animal species into Appendix 1. So they were given the highest level of protection. So they were moved from Appendix 2 to Appendix 1. So this is very important. So these species have been listed under Appendix 1 of CITES and will now enjoy the highest degree of protection, as there will be complete ban on their trade. So if a species is listed in Appendix 1 of CITES, then there will be no trade that should be carried out on these species. So this is the star tortoise. So for your understanding, I have added a picture. So Appendix 1 of CITES lists species that are most endangered among CITES listed animals and plants. They are threatened with extinction, and CITES prohibits international trade in specimens of species except when the purpose of import is not commercial, for instance for scientific research. So trade is completely banned on species that are listed in Appendix 1, except for research purposes. Trade cannot be carried out in these species. So this is about the conference of parties. So three conference of parties have been held. So conference of parties to the framework convention COP 25, to the climate change convention was held in Madrid. Then we have COP number 13, which was held to the convention on migratory species, held at Gandhinagar. Then we have COP number 18, which was held in Geneva, and this is a conference of parties to CITES. So very, very important for this year's prelims examination. So you must be prepared to answer questions. Then we will move on to another important development that has taken place. So recently the government of India has accorded Maharatna status. This is very important. So Maharatna status was given to two public sector companies. So what are those two companies which got the Maharatna status? So HPCL and Power Grid Corporation. So these two corporations were given the Maharatna status. So but how are PSUs granted Maharatna or Navaratna or Mini Ratna status? So we will look into the criteria in this lecture. So public sector enterprises are classified into Maharatna, Mini Ratna and Navaratna by Department of Public Undertakings under the Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises. So PSUs are classified into various categories. In fact, for profit making, PSUs are classified into three categories. They are Maharatna, Navaratna and Mini Ratna. So they are classified into various categories by the Department of Public Enterprises under the Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises. So how is a company designated as a Maharatna? So this is very, very important criteria. So first, that company must be having Navaratna status. So first, a company must have Navaratna status before it gets the Maharatna status. Second and most importantly, it should be listed on the Indian Stock Exchange with a minimum prescribed public share holding under SEBI regulations. So it must be traded on the Indian Stock Exchanges. Third, most importantly, it should have a turnover of 25,000 crores during the last 3 years. So it should have a turnover of 25,000 crores per annum. It should also have a net worth of 15,000 crores during the last 3 years. Net worth means the difference between assets and liabilities. So net assets minus liabilities give you the net worth. So average annual net worth must be 15,000 crores. So average annual net profit after tax must be 5,000 crores. They should have a profit of 5,000 crores. And most importantly, they should have significant global presence. So this is also mentioned. So they should have significant global presence. So in order to be declared as a Maharatna, a company should be a Navratna company. It should be listed on the Indian stock exchanges with a minimum prescribed shareholding of public shareholding. The average annual turnover must be 25,000 crores for the past 3 years. Net worth must be 15,000 crores and the net profit must be 5,000 crores. It should also have significant global presence / international operations. These are the 10. There are 10 Maharatna companies in India. So what are those 10 companies? So first is Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, Bharat Petroleum Corporation Limited, then we have Coal India Limited, GAIL, then Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited, Indian Oil Corporation Limited, NTPC Limited, is National Thermal Power Corporation Limited, Oil and Natural Gas Corporation Limited, Power Grid Corporation of India Limited, and Steel Authority of India Limited. So these are the 10 companies which enjoy Maharatna status. Then what is a Navaratna? So a Navaratna is a public sector enterprise which should be a mini Ratna. So initially it should be a mini Ratna and it will be later upgraded to a Navaratna. So it should have done very well over the past 5 years. So if a company does very well in the past 5 years and if it scores 60 points out of 100 points over the past 5 years, then it will be declared as a Navaratna. So there is an index that is used to measure the performance of the company. So there are six selected performance parameters. So first is net profit of the company. So net profit to net worth, then we have earnings per share, then we have profit before interest and taxes to turnover, then profit before depreciation, interest and taxes to capital employed, then we have manpower cost to total cost of production services, then we have intersectoral performance. So these are the six parameters. So if a company does well in these six parameters in the past 3 years, for 3 years out of the 5 years, then it will be declared as a Navaratna. So there are as many as 14 Navaratnas. There are 14 Navaratnas. So you must know what are the 14 Navaratnas. This is important for your examination. Then what is a mini Ratna? So in order to be called a mini Ratna, two criteria must be fulfilled. So first is it should be a profit making company. It should be making profit continuously for the past 3 years. Secondly, it should have a positive net worth. So it should have a net worth, that is, it should have more assets than liabilities. So if a company fulfills these two categories, then it will be classified as a mini Ratna. So financial and operational autonomy is granted to companies that have been declared as mini Ratna, Navaratna and Maharatna. So different types of autonomies are given to different categories. So as of 2019, there are 10 Maharatnas. So this is the latest numbers. So there are 10 Maharatnas, 73 Mini Ratnas and 14 Navaratnas out of the total of 300 central public sector enterprises. So this is something which you need to learn. So there are two companies which have been declared as Maharatnas, namely HPCL and Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. Then we will move on to the next topic, that is UNESCO Creative Cities. So on the eve of the World Cities Day, two cities from India were declared as creative cities by UNESCO. So World Cities Day is observed on the Cities Day. World Cities Day is observed on October 31st. So on the eve of the World Cities Day, UNESCO has declared two Indian cities as creative cities. So this is very important. So these two cities are, these two cities are Hyderabad and Mumbai. So two cities from India were declared as creative cities. So Hyderabad is declared as a creative city in the field of gastronomy, that is food. Then we have Mumbai, that is declared as a creative city in filmmaking. So two Indian cities have been declared as creative cities. So the number of creative cities in India are 5. So there are a total of 5 creative cities. So Hyderabad, which is a creative city in gastronomy. Then Mumbai, which is a creative city in film. Then we have Chennai and Varanasi, which have been declared as creative cities in the field of music. And we have Jaipur. Jaipur has been designated as a creative city in crafts and folk art. So this is very important. So on the occasion of the World Cities Day 2019, celebrated on 31st October, UNESCO announced that the cities of Mumbai and Hyderabad are joining the UNESCO Creative Cities Network. Mumbai has been designated as a creative city of film and Hyderabad a creative city of gastronomy. In India, they joined Chennai and Varanasi. Chennai and Varanasi are UNESCO cities of music, and Jaipur, UNESCO city of crafts and folk art. So the UNESCO Creative Cities Network was started in the year 2004. So this is an initiative of UNESCO which was started way back in 2004. And the objective here is to promote cooperation with and among cities that have identified creativity as a strategic factor for sustainable urban development. This is very important. So the UNESCO Creative Cities Network was created in 2004 to promote cooperation with and among cities that have identified creativity as a strategic factor for sustainable urban development. So overall, as of now, we have 246 creative cities all over the world. So they are identified in 7 categories. This is very, very important for your exam. So creative cities are identified in 7 categories. They are crafts and folk art, media arts, film, design, gastronomy, literature, and music. So crafts and folk arts, media arts, film, design, gastronomy, and literature. So this is about the Creative Cities Network. So let us move on to the last topic for today's lecture. This is a naval exercise that is in the news. This naval exercise is called Malabar. It's very, very important for your exam. So military exercises, you must study all the military exercises. Military exercises are carried out to strengthen defense cooperation between countries. India carries out military exercises with several countries of the world. So Malabar is one such naval exercise. In the military exercises, we have different types of military exercises. One is the exercise that is held between the armies of two countries. The other is the naval exercise. Then the third is the air force exercise. So this is a naval exercise. So there is an important development that has taken place with respect to exercise Malabar. So India plans to invite Australia to join the annual Malabar naval exercise that has so far included Japan and the USA, in a move that could risk China's help. So India has decided to invite Australia to the annual naval exercise, which is called the Malabar naval exercise. Till recently, this exercise actually includes only 3 countries, namely Japan, USA and India. So when Australia also joins this particular naval exercise, it brings together all the 4 countries in a grouping called Quad. So these 4 countries are informally called Quad. So the decision to include Australia in the drills, the first time all members of the regional grouping known as the Quad will be engaged at a military level, comes as Beijing and New Delhi are caught up in their worst border tensions in 4 decades. So there are significant tensions between India and China along the line of actual control. And this decision has been taken by India in this context. So that it is China actually has expressed anger at this decision of inviting Australia to this particular military exercise. The exercise will be held this year along the coast of Bay of Bengal. And you need to know something about Exercise Malabar. Exercise Malabar is a trilateral naval exercise. As I've already told you, it involves 3 countries. USA, Japan and India. However, when it was started in 1992, so it was initially started in 1992, when it was started, it included only two countries. They are USA and India. So it included only two countries. Japan became a permanent member of this naval exercise in 2015. So Japan joined as a permanent member only in 2015. But there was one development which happened in 2007. So in 2007, Australia and Singapore have joined as non-permanent members in this naval exercise. Australia and Singapore have joined India, Japan and USA in 2007 in the Malabar naval exercises. But when this naval exercise took place in 2007, China was very, very disappointed. They have expressed displeasure at all the countries who have participated in this naval exercise. Since then, Australia as well as India have maintained distance on this particular issue. So India never invited Australia to be part of this particular naval exercise, but now we have decided to invite them to join as a permanent member. So I think Australia will be joining as a permanent member this year, and from now onwards they will also be a permanent member in this naval exercise. So Australia-India relations have seen significant growth over the past few years. So for the last few years, Australia has been showing keen interest in participating in the exercise. Defense and security ties between India and Australia have been on the upswing in the last few years. Recently, India and Australia elevated their ties to a comprehensive strategic partnership and signed a landmark deal for reciprocal access to military bases for logistical support during an online summit between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his Australian counterpart Scott Morrison. So, recently, an online summit was held between India and Australia, and both countries have decided to elevate their ties to comprehensive strategic partnership. So this is a very important development. So India has upgraded its ties with Australia to a comprehensive strategic partnership, and we have signed an agreement called Mutual Logistics Support Agreement, and this agreement allows the militaries of two countries to use each other's bases for repair and replenishment of supplies, besides facilitating scaling up of overall defense cooperation. So this is about Exercise Malabar. So this is a naval exercise which till date has involved only three countries, but will also involve Australia from this year. So thank you for listening. So please call me at this number if you have any doubt, 767-3939-090. And please use this code RRUPSC if you subscribe to the Unacademy Learning App. If you like the video, please comment and subscribe to the channel. You can also follow me on this Telegram channel, Rajasekhar Reddy K. So thank you and have a good day.